Welcome, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
Jim Bamboulis is a travel and food writer, photographer, and vlogger based in Toronto. He runs Travel Mammal Media and hosts the Fact Up podcast, which included an interview with me.
When Jim is not traveling, he runs a food tour in Toronto's Greektown neighborhood. Jim, welcome. How are things going in Toronto?
First of all, thank you so much for inviting me onto your podcast. It is an honor. Things in Toronto, I think, are generally speaking, not bad. There's a lot of people who are, let me just say this, it's been a cold, long winter. And I think when the weather starts to get warmer, I think a lot of people in these parts are eager to get out, eager to get some vitamin D, eager to take some walks, get that heart rate up, start regretting all of the food decisions that we've made during the winter that has made us a little bit more insulated.
Now, Jim, we know you're right about food and travel, and you've got your Travel Mammal website to maintain, but with us being hunkered down because of COVID-19, how is this impacting the work that you would normally do?
Well, with respect to Travel Mammal, it has taken and continues to take a huge beating. I'll speak first about the food tours. The food tours that I do in Toronto's Greektown, there are two in total. There is a street food tour and a pastry crawl. The vendors that I have, bless them. I've checked up on all of them. They're still open. They're doing takeout. A lot of them are bakeries. And so a lot of them have allowed people to come in. They're still open, thankfully. However, the bookings have dried up, obviously, because travel, no one's traveling. The hunkering down, as you mentioned, we're all hunkered down. No one is really anxious to get back out and dine in into a restaurant. We can't, first of all, but secondly, the desire to do that, very hesitant. So travel from international visitors, null and void. Travel within the city, very, very limited. The desire to go out, pretty limited as well. So the Travel Mammal Tours itself has taken a huge beating because the food tours themselves involve, you know, the making of a coffee, the drinking of a coffee, the eating of a meal, the sitting down to eat at a meal, the art of a conversation. It's all about sitting down and enjoying the experience. The experience is non-existent right now. As a food photographer, as a travel writer, also taking a big hit. So on all levels, personally speaking, on a professional level, huge beating, huge beatdown, and it's probably going to continue for some time.
So how are you keeping travel alive then in the face of all of these challenges?
You know, it's going back and being as positive as possible and sharing that positivity and that inspiration to my viewers or new people who happen to stumble upon Travel Mammal. The whole idea is we will get there again, but here's where we've been. You may not, you know, go back in the next little while, but wow, can you ever share those memories? You know, that memory of DC, of LA, of London back in the day, throwback Thursdays are big, and that, you know, you traveled at one point, and look at the experience you had. And you will get there again. That's one way I do it. It's a lot of throwbacks, but at the same time, present day, it's also kind of going inside. I feel like the biggest travel journey you can take is going within inside of yourself and finding out who you are, what makes you tick. And there's no better time to do that in the past, you know, than the past 2-3 months where you really go introspective. And so in turn, what I've done with that is I've written a lot of personal articles over the past 6 months. It's almost like I've geared up for this. But it was, I guess, personal time to say, you know, this is kind of my travel story, my travel journey, and how it relates to, you know, the Athens marathon running from 4 years ago, how I celebrated my 40th birthday. Because food is such an integral part of who I am, and what Travel Mammal is all about. It's all about the food experience. That said, I grew up in a terrible neighborhood in East Toronto. But the one amazing thing that I took away from the childhood, despite the crime and the gang activity and the drugs that were circulating in the neighborhood, was the fact that food kept everybody together. So why don't I put an article down where the Jamaicans are sharing recipes with the Greeks and the Italians are sharing recipes with the Guyanese. And in turn, now we're bringing the community together despite the obstacles and despite what we're facing on a day-to-day danger level. We can still, you know, at least connect on a very human level. So what I've done is create content, be it food videos, how-to food videos, because we all have to eat. And what better time to showcase some of the dishes that I've always been inspired to make and put them into video form, first of all, but also write articles about kind of how travel, food, culture, generally experiences have inspired me over the years, and putting them down on paper or on a computer screen for people to be inspired and motivated for future experiences that, you know, we ultimately all hope to have.
So speaking of food, I know you did a very interesting pivot with your food tour business. Talk right. a little bit about what you're doing now.
Well, the idea, as I mentioned earlier with the food tours, is you physically go into the cafe and watch a Greek coffee being made. You can't do that now. You know, you're watching the meat spin, and you're having a gyro topped with the onions and the tzatziki, making your breath smell awful, but man, are you loving it. And you know, the baklava in the end with the honey and the pistachios, these are experiences that you smell, that you taste, that you feel. And the conversation, you know, plays such a huge role in that, you know, you're slowing down and enjoying the food experience. Because we can't do that, obviously, I've decided to, you know, package that food experience and present it as a gift bag. So in that gift bag now, I include Greek coffee, Greek stuffed vine leaves. There's a story there. My mom used to pick leaves from the side of the road and dry them when I was a kid. And in turn, she would dry them and then stuff them with the rice and the meat, the ground beef, and then she'd make them. Now, that's a gourmet item at several supermarkets around the continent. You buy those by the pound. My mom used to make those, you know, for free from leaves from the side of the road. My point with all that is you're now getting a food experience, but bagged. But you're getting a variety of flavors that kind of showcase the sweet and the savory of the Greek food experience. So you're getting the stuffed vine leaves, you're getting the coffee, you're getting mastic gum, which is an ancient gum based from a tree resin in Chios in Greece, where, anyway, it's a whole story. But the idea is, why don't I combine all the flavors that you would expect from my food tour in a bag, compact, you enjoy at your time, but I deliver it to your door disinfected. And so, you know, you may not be able to leave the house, but I will support my small business vendors in the process, keep those guys going, compile a little kind of gift bag for you and deliver it to your door so you can enjoy the flavors of the city, the flavors of the world, in this case, they're Greek, to your doorstep.
So Jim, what do you think travel is going to look like though, post-corona?
You know, it's a funny thing. There was someone who called me today and they wanted to put together a food tour in October. And I'll tell you what I told this particular gentleman. It's peace of mind. Peace of mind is going to be it. If I'm traveling, I want to know that my airline that I'm traveling with is taking all the precautions that it needs to take to make not only myself, but to make anyone who's traveling feel as if they're traveling with the best possible way and the safest way to do so. My hotel, same thing. What is the hotel doing? What is the Airbnb doing? What is the food tour guide doing when I'm there? What is the cab driver doing? What is the Uber driver doing to make me feel as if I'm being transported safely? The travel experience is going to be far different. We'll rebound, I feel, in the next 2 to 3 years. I think it's going to take a while. I think small steps, baby steps to get people in the train of thought that it's now turning from a negative to a little bit more of a positive as time goes along, but to reassure travelers constantly, not only travelers, anybody who's venturing out, that you will be taken care of responsibly. We have a corporate mandate to make sure that everything's okay. And I feel that because the airlines have lost a lot of money, the hotels have lost a lot of money, destinations have lost a lot of money, I don't think they can gamble with taking shortcuts.
Yeah, I think clearly when it comes to travel, safety and cleanliness are going to have to be at the top of what every operator in the space mm-hmm. does. And so that is a good thing. want to shift gears some. I know you're a sportscaster in a previous life, and you've photographed the Athens Marathon. I, too, had the good fortune of participating in one of the last marathons to be run before COVID-19 took place, and that was the Houston Marathon. So what do you think the future holds for sporting events and for large gatherings like marathons, and where do you see it going, perhaps?
Oh, wow. That is an amazing question. That's really hard to say. You're talking about the postponement of the Olympics this year. You're also talking about the potential postponement of the Olympics next year. I've seen articles that have argued the elimination of the Olympics altogether for a while. That's a really tough question. If you're talking about, certain provinces and states now slowly easing restrictions, and you're having, I think it's NBA teams that are slowly kind of bringing people back. I know there's a lot of horse tracks that are now allowing their trainers to bring their horses into the track and kind of training them a little bit, cleaning, et cetera. Really tough question to answer. I think for a while, you're not going to be able to have people's confidence that high to be able to now sign up for a marathon that they know will have another 15, 20, 25,000 people there in close contacts. That starting line is going to be a zoo.
Yeah.
The finish line, not so much, but the finish line as well. If you're talking about spectating and you're talking about people gathering to cheer people on, I know in Athens, there's, you run into the Olympic Stadium from 1896 and it's an exhilarating feeling. And you have another 10, 15,000 people in the stands cheering on the kids who are coming in, the first woman who to finish, cross the line, the first man, the first Greek, the first everything. You're having vendors there with food. Oh, it's really tough to say, but something like that, I can't even begin to talk about the precautions that organizers would have to take to safeguard spectators in an NBA game, hockey game, football, much less a marathon with 50,000 people. That's going to take a long, long time.
It's a new world that awaits us, whether it's sports, travel, you name it. So since you're in Toronto, Toronto is a big part of our lives on this end here. Tanya and I were engaged in Toronto, and mm-hmm. I know you've spent a big chunk of your life there. What is it that you love about Toronto?
What do I love about Toronto? Where do I start? Toronto is one of those cities where you can eat the world in a day. Toronto is a place where you can, and I focus on food. you can have an Afghan lunch and a South African dinner in the same day. You can have an Egyptian drink with a pisco sour after midnight. It's truly the blending of so many millions of people who bring their culture, and you find a mosque next to an Orthodox church. And you find restaurants next to each other. It's an amazing combination of people who get along, for the most part. But the safety, the food, just the way of life. It's great. I mean, the weather is something to be desired, but generally speaking, it's the city and its feeling. And because there's so much history here with respect to multi ethnicity, the desire to be a part of it is electric. It's magnetic.
Sorry, do you have a favorite place you like to go?
Not really.
Okay.
No, it's all good. I mean, on a travel kind of physical level, I grew up in the East End, so you have the Scarborough Bluffs, which is like these giant cliffs that overlook the lake. That's a gorgeous natural wonder, and it's free. You have, an Indian temple in the West End that's just this majestic temple. One of nine, I think, in North America. That's free. There's a lot of places and a lot of restaurants and just a lot of parks. It's They call Toronto the city within a park. And so if you were to fly, if you were to fly over Toronto, which you have, it's fairly green. And a lot of the side streets that you see in neighborhoods like Little Italy, Little Portugal, Koreatown, Greektown, you know, there's trees every 100 feet. And in the summertime, when those trees are in bloom, they just kind of create that canopy over the street. That alone to me is beautiful. And the fact that, you know, parents are leaving toys from their own home into the sand pits at public parks, and those toys aren't stolen 5 minutes later, that's Toronto. But the fact that a lot of people live pretty harmoniously and are able to share traditions and cultures between each other, that's unbeatable. It's what I think Steve Martin or somebody called it on 30 Rock. I think it was Steve Martin's character. Toronto is like New York without the stuff. you don't get that kind of heart pumping New York energy, but you still have that big city feel where it feels like a New York, just based on the energy of the people, energy of the food, the aromas that come out of the restaurants, the neighborhoods, and you know, I always like to say, you know, in Greektown, the neighborhood watch, for example, in Greektown is not the police. It's the Greek grandmother who's peering through the window. Who is this across the street? That to me is Toronto. So it's old and new world together, pretty harmoniously, enjoying each other's flavors, energy, company.
So how have people been caring for each other, Jim, during this time? Have you seen acts of kindness that have really even surprised you?
You know, I'm blessed enough to know a lot of restaurateurs. And I think from what I understand from a lot of restaurateurs is they'll order directly from the restaurateur and leave extra money for their own families. So there's a pizza restaurant in the West End where he's making, you know, 100 pizzas a day, which is ridiculous, but it's necessary. Pizza is pizza. And he's a small business owner. And the community has flocked to him because he's been there for 25, 30 years. And he just had his sixth kid, by the way. And wow. It's amazing because you have six kids I can't even begin to just understand that. But the idea that the community has flocked to him and the communities around the city and around the country, I could safely say, have flocked to small businesses with the desire to keep them going as much as possible and give them a little bit more extra to help their families kind of keep going. You know, you have a lot of people in the last couple of weeks that I've seen on drives where they'll get a couple of lawn chairs and they'll park their lawn chairs on their neighbor's lawn, 10, 12, 15 feet apart, but they'll have those conversations. I don't know if that's allowed, to be honest, but the idea that you're checking in with each other and maybe not so much, you know, exchanging recipes or exchanging food, but you're putting a face to a connection that you'd otherwise have in closer contact, to at least kind of walk by and say hello to your neighbor is amazing.
Now, Jim, with so many of us having to stay home and we've given up a lot in terms of the lives that we've known, what are you looking to do or where are you looking to go once this is behind us?
You know, there's so many places. but it's a matter of finances at this point. The giving up of relatively consistent income, even as an independent kind of business, small business owner, has been really challenging. If you were to tell me, if you're asking me my top destinations to kind of explore after this, there's a few. Japan has always been on my list. I would love to immerse myself in Japan for at least a month. Easter Island off Chile, just kind of do the spine of Chile and then take that 5-hour flight west into the Pacific and explore Easter Island. You know, South Africa is on my list. There's so many places, but there's also places that I'd love to revisit, like the Iceland of the world. You know, the ring road in Iceland would be an amazing thing, and that was actually planned in the this past winter, but we figured wait till the weather gets warmer, because you don't want to be, you know, stuck in maybe a ring road situation in the middle of December in the winter in Iceland. That now probably gets delayed by at least a year or two.
Yeah.
And Iceland is not cheap.
Yes, so, we know.
Right. So when you combine the lack of finances with what it takes to now travel, And who knows, you know, after this, maybe flights get more expensive because they have to make up losses. Hotel prices get more expensive because they have to make up losses. So now you're weighing whether it's worth it or not, or whether you have to wait a little bit longer, or whether you bite the bullet and just go. But for me now, I mean, that's international. For me now, it's exploring more of Canada. We have such a big country here, but the problem that we have in Canada is flights are not cheap to travel within the country. And so it's actually cheaper to fly from Toronto to Paris on any given day back in the day than it is to go from Toronto to Vancouver, which is across the same country. But the staycation, I think for me, is a top priority over the next maybe year or two, exploring more of the East Coast, exploring more of the middle of the country, underestimated, underrated, and you know, parts of the country. And I feel as Canadians, we've always been so humble. You know, the humility gets thrown out the window as far as I'm concerned. Explore the country. It's beautiful. And I think for the next little while, enjoy the staycation. And it's really not that bad. It's Canada. It's awesome.
So let's pretend that all is well in the world. We don't have any financial concerns. You have booked your trip to Japan or South Africa, very long haul flight. In that ideal world, if you had your choice to sit next to anybody on a long haul flight, past or present, who would that be?
Oh, wow. You know, Robin Williams, for the sheer entertainment and the lessons that I'd probably learn eventually over a long haul, I can't imagine that. Einstein is on that list. You know, Plato's on that list. Socrates is on that list. Any Stoic. There's a list that's kind of circulating. But off the top, people generally that I feel I would learn immensely from, that either their teachings have been forgotten, or their teachings are alive and well, but we underestimate them.
Jim, thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate your time. And to our audience, just keep smiling, guys.